That's great. All right. Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. We're going to call the meeting to order. We're going to resume this 135th meeting of the Tennessee Advisory Commission on Intergovernmental Relations. Good to see all of you this morning. Thank you all for your attention yesterday. That was a very interesting session. I've had a lot of post-session comments about it and everything, and a lot of food for thought. Chairman Wergo, did you get rested up? Thank you. Thank you, Senator Tracy. Yeah, no, that's good. That's good. I've gotten some interesting emails about it since yesterday's proceedings. All right, we're going to get underway here today, beginning at tab 4. And this is the only action item that we have today in terms of what we need to vote on for approval. This is the final report on the process, zoning process, and consent to rezone private property. So, Lanice?
We'll have Bill Terry, Senior Research Consultant, step to the podium to present the report.
I was kind of waiting for the crowd to Bill. Doesn't seem to be as much interest in this topic, does it? Oh, well, that's the way planning is, you know. Mr. Chairman, members of the commission, Director Patrick, I'm here to present a short summary of what we did last month. You've already heard the report as presented. I'm not going to repeat it, but I will summarize a few bullet points that were raised in the report. The report pointed out that individual consent would result in a checkerboard zoning map pattern, possibility of incompatible land uses next to each other. It would disrupt zoning efforts that are based on community consent. Communities across the state are already exceeding state law in providing notice. And the approach is being used by cities and counties across the state include increasing the number of newspaper notices, requiring signs on the property, requiring planning commissions to hold public hearings, requiring notice by mail, including notice to surrounding property owners, clearly defining that in the law, and allowing local governments to charge the party requesting rezoning to pay for any additional costs. By coincidence, yesterday morning I had a conversation with Mayor Franklin and one of his senior planners about just this issue, and they use three additional steps. They advertise in the newspaper as required by law, but they also post signs on the properties. They send out notice by mail, I think first class, to not only the property owners, but also surrounding property owners. And they define the surrounding property owners as being within 500 feet of the site. So that's what the city of Franklin does, and I think other cities do as well. One thing that was brought up at the last meeting was Mr. Chairman asked about takings issue, because we were talking about downzoning. And so he suggested that takings issue should be referenced in the report. So we added some language on that, which is included. And it's found in the section right after the discussion on downzoning of property in Knoxville. And so it's on page 7. I'll go over that briefly. Property owners who object to zoning decisions in some cases have filed lawsuits against local governments, claiming that the rezonings of their property were regulatory takings based on constitutional prohibitions against taking private property without just compensation. Typically, that applies to the physical taking of property, as would happen in a case of eminent domain. However, in 1922, the U.S. Supreme Court ruled in Pennsylvania Coal versus Mahan that the general rule, at least, is that while property may be regulated to a certain extent, if regulation goes too far, it will be recognized as a taking. The U.S. Supreme Court has also recognized a regulatory taking when a regulation required an owner of property to allow a physical invasion of that property, or it deprived the owner of all economically beneficial use of the property. Those are also takings. The rule established by the court in the Penn Central versus New York City case for takings that fall short of a physical invasion and deprivation of all economically beneficial uses is that regulations are to be analyzed using the following factors. The economic impact of the regulation on the owner, the extent to which the regulations interfere with investment-backed expectations, and the character of the government action. As you can tell, that's pretty general in some ways, but so it's left up to the lower courts to interpret those three factors in any case that comes before them on a taking issue. In Tennessee, the Supreme Court ruled in August of 2014 in the Phillips versus Montgomery County case that Article 1, Chapter, Section 21 of the Tennessee Constitution encompasses regulatory takings in the same manner as the U.S. Constitution. Before this decision was made by the court, any takings claim filed in Tennessee had to be based on the Fifth Amendment of the Constitution, which prohibits taking without just compensation, and the 14th Amendment, which extends that restriction to the states. The Phillips case resulted from the disapproval of a subdivision plat, not from a zoning action. The local planning commission disapproved the plat for the sole reason that a proposed highway would be coming along the route where the subdivision was going to be developed. Tennessee Supreme Court decided that that was a taking under inverse condemnation section of the Tennessee Constitution and remanded the case back to the lower courts for further proceedings to determine really whether the Planning Commission's denial was a taking. As of yet, that has not been done. The lower court, which is Circuit Court in Montgomery County, has not ruled upon that matter. There was, to bring you up to date though, there was a second lawsuit in this case as well that was filed in Chancery Court asking the court to determine that the Planning Commission's action was arbitrary and capricious. Now that case has been reheard, but no decision has been reached as of yet. Any questions?
Questions for Mr. Terry, Chairman, with Senator Tracy, and then Chairman Wargo.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I think from now on we need to advertise Mr. Terry's presentation a little bit better so we can get a better crowd for him. That'd be my recommendation.
There you go.
All right, we'll take that under advisement. Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
I appreciate that, Senator Tracy.
Chairman Wargo.
Is there any time frame when we think that the decision will come for this case?
It's entirely up to the courts and the parties at hand.
That's what I thought. Thank you.
Yes, I understand that they're waiting on their decision of the Chancery Court before they move forward with any kind of action in Circuit Court.
All right, so the bottom line, as I see it, really is sort of on page 4, that giving individual property owners veto power over rezonings would disrupt zoning efforts based on community consent expressed through local, elected legislative bodies, and could create problems for neighborhoods by allowing incompatible land uses next to each other. But there are some additional things that could be done and are being done by some local communities already, mm-hmm. and those are pretty well spelled out in the report. All right. Ready to vote? All right. Been properly moved and seconded that we approve the report as submitted. All in favor signify by saying aye. Aye. Any opposed or abstaining? All right. The report's approved. Thank you, Mr. Carey. Thank you, members. Now we move on to tab 5, Homestead Exemption in Tennessee, Finding a Balance. This is a draft report, as are the next several tabs. Good morning, sir.
Morning.
Welcome.
All right. Good morning, members of the commission. My name is Tyler Carpenter. I'm happy to be back before you presenting the draft report on the homestead exemption and Tennessee bankruptcy. This will be for your review and comment. The report responds to Public Chapter 326, Acts of 2015, requiring the Commission to study the homestead exemption amounts in Tennessee and determine whether they should be increased to accurately reflect the cost of living. The report can be found under tab 5. And on the first day of the September meeting, I provided background on this topic and an overview of what other states are doing with regard to the homestead exemption. On the second day of that meeting, you heard from a panel of bankruptcy attorneys, trustees, and other interested parties who presented their perspectives on the bankruptcy process and the application of the homestead exemption. And minutes of the panel discussion can be found in Appendix E on page 34. To briefly recap, the homestead exemption in Tennessee primarily applies in bankruptcy and seeks to balance the interests of debtors and creditors. Through the bankruptcy process, debtors may exempt some of their equity, and creditors may receive a portion of the money owed to them. As I explained at the last meeting, consumer lending experienced great change during the mid to late 1900s, and this led to the Bankruptcy Reform Act of 1978, which strengthened the bankruptcy process and established a federal set of exemptions, including the homestead exemption. The federal homestead exemption amount at the time was set at $7,500 and has since grown to $22,975, which is also subject to doubling for joint owners. Around the time of the 1978 reform, Tennessee's homestead exemption was $5,000 for an individual and $7,500 for joint owners, and these amounts have never been increased and continue to lose value. To further illustrate the erosion in the value of the individual and joint homestead exemptions in Tennessee, please refer to Figure 2 on page 9. Here you can see how housing prices have compared to the homestead exemption federally and in Tennessee between 1975 and 2015. I'll give you a second to look at that. And we've also provided a table in Appendix D on page 32 that provides some of the data behind that map and a little more beyond that. And that shows the homestead exemption as a percentage of median housing prices in Tennessee and the U.S. over the same period. In the table, you can see that over a period of 35 years, this percentage in Tennessee declined from 12% to 4% for individuals and 16% to 5% for joint owners. The federal homestead exemption has not seen such a drastic decline. Over the same period, the federal homestead exemption as a percentage of U.S. median housing prices declined from 20% to 15%. The next adjustment of the federal homestead exemption will occur in April of 2016. Now, although these amounts in Tennessee haven't been increased for most debtors and are out of date, the General Assembly has granted larger exemptions to four groups of filers, and a list of these can be found on page 3, but I will briefly cover them. For an individual age 62 or older, they establish an exemption of $12,500. For a married couple with only one spouse, age 62 or older, the exemption is $20,000. For married couples with both spouses, age 62 or older, the exemption is $25,000. And all three of those newly established categories were established in 2004. And the last one is for an individual with custody of a minor child, the exemption is $25,000. And because of a court ruling, that number can be doubled for two individuals who share custody of a minor child. The panel you heard from at the last meeting raised an issue of using exemptions in conjunction with the homestead exemption in Tennessee and while using federal exemptions. The report explains that federal homestead exemptions offer filers more flexibility, allowing them to apply up to $11,500 of their unused homestead exemption to other real or personal property. There are 11 states that also allow filers to use a portion of their unused homestead exemption for other property. But like most states, Tennessee does not. Federal exemptions also include $1,225 for other real and personal property, which may be stacked with the $11,500, bringing that total to $12,725. This flexibility allows renters to exempt more of their personal property than Tennessee's exemptions currently allow. Tennessee's personal property exemption is $10,000. The report also provides a comparison of the homestead exemption in Tennessee to other states in maps 1 and 2 on pages 12 and 13. As you can see, Tennessee offers the lowest homestead exemption amounts for an individual at $5,000, with the exception of Arkansas. Arkansas offers individuals an exemption of $800, but offers joint filers who are married an unlimited exemption. All filers, however, are able to choose between state and federal exemptions, so those who are limited to $800 may choose federal and receive the $22,975. Like Tennessee, Kentucky and Virginia also offer a $5,000 individual homestead exemption, but both allow doubling to $10,000 for joint filers. And Kentucky allows residents to choose between state and federal exemptions. Table 2 on pages 17 through 21 provide additional details of each state and the exemptions offered. The maps have been updated since the last meeting to reflect recent legislation, which increased the exemptions in Colorado and Alabama. And the table has been changed to include each state and their exemption offerings. This past summer, Alabama's legislature voted unanimously to triple its homestead exemption amounts for individuals, which had been unchanged since 1980. And that amount changed from $5,000 to $15,000, and this amount will be adjusted for inflation going forward. The amount is also doubled for joint filers. Alaska, California, Indiana, Michigan, Minnesota, Ohio, and South Carolina also index their exemptions for inflation. If Tennessee's homestead exemption amounts for individuals and joint filers had kept pace with inflation since their adoption roughly 35 years ago, they would currently be valued at $16,304 and $21,645. If the exemption for joint filers was double the exemption for individuals, it would currently be valued at $32,608. A simpler way to bring these figures up to date and keep them up to date would be to adopt the federal homestead exemption amounts, which are adjusted for inflation every 3 years. Tennessee's exemption amounts for debtors with custody of a minor child are currently more than those amounts and would need to be grandfathered until the federal exemption amounts catches up with it. And with that, I'd be happy to take any questions.
Any questions? I've got a couple of observations and some questions. And these are technical but minor but important. Several places you refer to state and federal bankruptcy laws, and
yes,
that's imprecise. I mean, they're bankruptcy laws are federal laws. There are state laws on exemptions and things, but I think, for example, on page 6, where it says state and federal bankruptcy laws, it shouldn't. Page 7 refers to says like most states bankruptcy laws. Again, that's something that's been pointed out that is inartful, if not inaccurate. And another very technical point, but on page 5, the Bankruptcy Reform Act of 1978, it didn't really establish the federal bankruptcy courts. It altered them. It sort of restructured them. But it's, again, to be precise, I'd change the wording of that. Now, one of the issues that has been addressed has been raised by Linda Knight, who is here. I didn't ask her to be prepared to speak, but since she is here, she's expressed some concerns about creating different sets of exemptions, different types of exemptions, separate sets of exemptions, and I'm wondering if we could hear from her on that. Would that be all right, members? Yeah. And again, I know she's always prepared, even though I didn't ask her to be prepared to speak.
Good morning. Would you like me to answer questions or just?
Well, just tell that you had raised concerns about creating separate sets of exemptions, and as you speak, if you'd pull that microphone up close to your mouth, and the sound's really not very good in here.
Well, thank you. I'm honored to be asked to speak. Thank you, Senator Norris. I do have a lot of concerns about adopting two different sets of exemptions, depending on whether a debtor is in Chapter 7 or Chapter 13. First of all, the Bankruptcy Code itself contains incentives to file Chapter 13, and in some cases, one is almost forced to file Chapter 13 if one fits into certain mathematical computations of one's income and expenses. One point is that under Chapter 13, a debtor must, this is complicated, a debtor must pay to unsecured creditors a dividend the present value of which is at least as large as the dividend that the creditors would receive in a Chapter 7. So if you have bigger exemptions in Chapter 13, in order to guide or direct a debtor into Chapter 13, he still has to compute the Chapter 13 plan to provide a dividend that equates to what the debtor would pay to creditors in Chapter 7 with a lower exemption. So having a higher exemption in Chapter 13 doesn't make any difference. Your plan still has to pay as much as a Chapter 7 case would present value to the confirmation of the plan. Also in Chapter 13, the purpose is to keep one's assets and pay to unsecured creditors, the equivalent of what they would get in Chapter 7 over a period of up to 5 years. So you don't really utilize the exemptions in Chapter 13. They're just part of the mathematical computation that you have to do in order to determine what your Chapter 13 plan has to pay. Another reason to that's built into the code to direct a debtor to 13 is that if the debtor has engaged in certain conduct that would render his debt to somebody non-dischargeable in Chapter 7, it may still be dischargeable in Chapter 13. So if a debtor is guilty of certain kinds of conduct, he might be able to discharge that debt in a 13 even if he wouldn't in a 7. Also, and this is just practical, the bankruptcy system depends upon as much simplicity as possible and for cases to flow through the system as quickly and simply and in as uncomplicated a manner as possible. And if you add an additional complication of a second set of exemptions, it's going to make what's already an overly complicated system even more complicated, both for the Chapter 13 or 7, the Chapter 13 debtors, and for their attorneys and for creditors and creditors' attorneys. Also, many Chapter 13 cases are not successful, so they either get converted to Chapter 7 or they get dismissed. If they are converted to Chapter 7, then you have to recompute everything because you've computed your Chapter 13 on one set of exemptions, and then you convert and you have to recompute your exemptions in Chapter 7, and again, that adds administrative difficulty and overhead to the attorneys, which has to be passed on to somebody or absorbed by the attorney. The attorney fees in consumer bankruptcy cases went up substantially when the Bankruptcy Code amendments were passed in 2005 because representing a consumer debtor became much more time-consuming and complicated, and so attorney fees went up as it was. On the other hand, if the 13 is dismissed, then a lot of attorneys won't collect their fees because there's no Chapter 13 trustee paying their fees monthly out of the distributions under the plan. Or the debtor is back under non-bankruptcy law, and so he'd be back under state law exemptions when his creditors go back after him in state court. Another practical point is that consumer debtors are often unsophisticated and don't understand what's happening to them anyway. And it's so from the Chapter 13 debtors' perspective or Chapter 7 debtors' perspective to have different sets of exemptions if the case is converted from a 13 to a 7 is going to make it even harder for the debtor to understand and provide information to his or her attorney. Also, some bankruptcy cases, even though it's been pointed out that most of them are beyond the debtor's control if they're due to divorce or medical situations or job loss, sometimes the bankruptcies result from just really bad financial decisions or life decisions. And as was pointed out in the last hearing and in the report, it's the unsecured creditors that really pay for the homestead, for any of the exemptions, the homestead exemption included. So if a debtor is really not deserving of sympathy, shall we say, there's really no point in penalizing his unsecured creditors by an increased exemption or different sets of exemptions. So
I think what we'll do, having taken that into account, is to incorporate those concerns into the report. You had sent a good memorandum, which, with your permission, I'll submit to the staff.
Thank
you for further detail, but I really appreciate your following this so closely and bringing it to our attention today.
Thank you, Senator.
Thank you, Ms. Knight. I should have asked any questions there. Okay. Tim.
Is there any other questions?
Mayor Bickers. There we go.
Guess they vetoed me. Didn't know you had that power. Tyler, I want to congratulate you. I thought you did an excellent job with this report. There are a couple of comments I would make to consider. And one is, as I read this, and as I think most readers would interpret it, this seems to be focused almost entirely from the bankruptcy end. On page 10, you talk about the fact that the exemption exists for debtors outside of judgment debtors outside of bankruptcy, but there's very little other discussion. And it may be, and I'm not sure, but I suspect there may be as much application of the homestead exemption with regard to seeking relief from by judgment debtors outside of bankruptcy as there is within. And I wonder if we shouldn't enhance that discussion to reflect that this will have an impact on people who choose not to file bankruptcy but seek to avoid a debt or full payment of a debt or execution on the debt using the homestead exemption. Because if you increase it for purposes of bankruptcy, but you're also increasing it for people who are not filing bankruptcy. To me, that's something we ought to at least discuss maybe a little more fully. The other suggestion I had is we have a discussion of the different exemption rates by state, and look at that. But there's a whole host of exemptions that are available to debtors, and you capture that in Appendix C, where you compare Tennessee and the federal exemption. For example, Tennessee has a $10,000 wild card exemption for personal property that's actually, so while the homestead exemption may be less than other states, we have other exemptions that provide additional protection of assets over and above one's equity in one's home. I'm wondering if we shouldn't have some discussion of the total exemptions available in Tennessee to someone instead of, because while one of the exemptions may be lower, if you look at the totality of exemptions compared to other jurisdictions, it may be that while we're below on homestead, if you look at the total impact, we're pretty close. And it may just be how you calculate that. And, that's make that. And the other and this is just my perspective, coming from where I am and what I've done in my life, there's discussion about the finding a balance between the interest of debtors and creditors. I didn't read much about the interest of creditors and the impact that bankruptcy have on creditors and on governments, right? The more bankruptcies we have, the more foreclosures we have in our municipalities and our counties, the greater impact that has on property values, which impacts the property tax base, which impacts our revenues. So we ought to be doing everything we can to eliminate or discourage bankruptcy filings, and I'm not sure we have the discussion as to whether or not raising the exemption would have a tendency to increase filings, where we're already number one in the country with a per capita filing rate double the national average. Is that a good thing? By raising this exemption, if we increase the bankruptcy filings, what's the impact on our governments and it as a whole? Those are my comments. I thought you did a wonderful job. I'm not trying to be critical, but those are some things that we might want to consider.
Thank you.
Senator Yarbrough.
I was sort of startled by something that I read in the report, and I just wanted to make sure that this is accurate and see if it tracks what we see in other states. So, the Homestead exemption dates back to 1852 when it was $500 in Tennessee at that point.
That's correct.
And then 18 years later, after the Civil War in 1870, it doubled to 1,000. And in the intervening, 145 years, we've raised it one time to $5,000.
Right. But so between 1870 and 1978, it was raised one time to $5,000. So for an individual, that's not over the age
without
of 62.
The variation.
Yes, that's correct. It's only been raised one time since 1870.
And I mean, the one thing I'm sort of curious about is whether we want to really try to build something into this that prevents the sort of constant tinkering, but that kind of puts this thing on some sort of on a track that we don't have to like revisit this or ignore it, and sort of go through the. I mean, obviously, like the. If we hear from creditors' counsel or debtors' counsel, they're going to have a different opinion about the validity of the homestead exemption, whether it should exist, what amount it should be, and sort of, if we're going to like really take a look at this issue and adjust it in some way, whether we would want to do so in such a way that would create something that's a little bit more sustainable and that would, prevent us having the sort of lack of movement that creates the incentive for tinkering for certain categories to adjust things along the way.
I'm trying to remember what testimony we had, Senator, on it's the equivalent of a COLA. I'm trying to think of what else we could call it, but some kind of a built-in adjustment. Senator Yarbrough, and then
I still want to think more about the report, but I think that is one of the upsides of the adopting the federal system is that there's always downsides to adopting any type of federal system, but the adopting something that we do know is subject to change and variation that doesn't sort of build in something that could be counter could run into counter market difficulties.
Representative Carter.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Our panels this year have just been outstanding. I mean, just really excellent. And I appreciate that, Lanise. It's just been amazing. One of the things that amazed me about this discussion with Mayor Bickers' comments last time was, does this really matter? What I came out of our last meeting with is that there were, 96 or 97% of the people that are upside down in their homes, and this is really form over substance. It may make us look good on a headline in the newspaper to certain areas of the economy, but we're really not changing anything. if we increase the exemptions, we're going to increase it to the point where people with true assets are going to be able to avoid debt. And so I'm concerned about the impact of that. But I think I'm most influenced by the fact that our excellent panel, both sides, creditors and debtors, said that it's really not going to have any impact on about 96% of the people because they borrowed 100% of their home, they're upside down, and it really doesn't matter anyway. So I'm a little afraid to fix a problem that doesn't exist. That's just my opinion. Thank you so much.
Other comments, questions? Tyler, great job. Thank you. We'll see you next time.
Thank you.
In final form. Okay. Moving right along, behind tab 6, Hotel Motel. Another draft report for review and comment. Michael Mount, take it away.
Thank you, Chairman. Commissioners, my name is Michael Mount, and I'll be presenting on the lodging taxes, also known as hotel motel taxes. After going through the background in Tennessee, we'll be looking at the economic effects, other states' tax structures, and ending with public input. And you should have two handouts, two maps. One is on cities and one's on counties, maps of the United States. In Tennessee, the state and local sales taxes do apply to lodging up to 9.75%. And on top of that, most counties and some cities have a lodging tax. 5% is the most common rate, and rates in half of the cities that levy a lodging tax are layered on top of their county's lodging tax. And so the combined rate can be as high as 19.75%, and this is the case in 6 cities in Tennessee. Local governments are authorized by the state. All home rule cities are authorized to 5%, except for Johnson City, which is authorized to 7%. And all three metropolitans are authorized to 3%, except Nashville, which is authorized to 6% plus a $2.50 tax. Most other counties and some of the other cities are authorized to various rates. Most of them are 5%, but it can be as high as a 10% authorization, with the exception of one city that doesn't appear to have a maximum authorized rate. That is Lexington in Henderson County. Besides Lexington, we investigated where in the state it might be possible for cities and counties to get a lodging tax greater than 20%, and found that any city in 9 counties adopting home rule and then levying the maximum 5% rate could overlap their county's rate and get to as high as 24.75%, which is the case in Cheatham County, who is authorized to 10%. In one other case, in Sullivan County, the portion that is Johnson City in Sullivan County, which has a 7% rate, could, if Sullivan County were to adopt its maximum 5% rate, the total would be 21.75%. In all other cases, the maximum authorized rates are 19.75% and or less. The lodging tax laws in Tennessee, most are local governments that are authorized or authorized by private act, but some also by general law. A 1988 law prohibited city and county overlapping of lodging taxes by private act, but this law has been amended 14 times. In addition, home rule cities can overlap. We were asked to look at the economic effects of lodging taxes. we looked at a U.S. Travel Association report that said tourism and hospitality revenue in Tennessee is at an all-time high. It grew 6% in 2014 to $17.2 billion. Of that, accommodations GDP is about $2 billion and is about 0.72% of Tennessee's economy. And this is a little bit less than the U.S. average. I looked at 10-year growth in Tennessee and all of the bordering states, and Tennessee growth in accommodations GDP was second to last ahead of Mississippi. That appears to have been an impact of the recession, the recent recession. Lodgers are not very sensitive to the hotel tax, according to several studies that we looked at. And by sensitivity, I mean how much does an increase in the rate or in the tax, how much does that affect or decrease lodging stays? Besides this lack of sensitivity, there is some variation in the sensitivity based on some other factors. Lodgers are less sensitive in destination cities. They're also less sensitive when they are choosing among economy hotels. But we did find that different lodging tax rates in close proximity to each other can hurt the hotels in the higher taxed areas. All 50 states have some lodging tax, and 47 of the states tax lodging. 35 of those, it's because they're applying their state sales tax to lodging, and that includes Tennessee. 43 states, including Tennessee, authorize local governments to tax lodging, and 32 allow both city and county lodging taxes. Only four of those do not allow any city and county overlapping of lodging taxes. 8 authorize cities but not counties, and 3 authorize counties but not cities. In Appendix D on page 53, you'll find a summary of what other states do authorize for lodging taxes. Of the 43 states that authorize lodging taxes, and here I'll be referring to the two maps that you have. Most of the states are shaded in green. And these are the states with blanket authority, and they mostly cap lodging tax rates and earmark at least a portion of the lodging tax. All the states that limit authority to certain classes, they all cap rates, and all but one of them earmarks at least a portion of the tax. And of the states that are like Tennessee that usually grant authority individually, only Missouri caps or earmarks, and only for cities, and the rest neither cap nor earmark. Finally, our final issue is public input. We found that 11 states require a referendum for levying a lodging tax. In Tennessee, home rule cities can choose to levy a lodging tax by referendum, but they choose not to. We looked at California, which has a referendum for every lodging tax that they levy, and found that voters approve about 2/3 of them, except in the cases for when the lodging tax will be earmarked. There's a 2/3 supermajority requirement, and in those cases, only 40% are approved. In addition to referendum, 5 states require public hearings. That is my presentation. Are there any questions?
Chairman Tracy.
Couple questions. You made a couple of comments there. You went through them pretty quick, but I picked them up. First of all, tourism's up 6%, if I understood you correct, in Tennessee, and that's good. And I assume with the tourism up, our stays in hotels are going to be up also. And you also said in your presentation that majority of the people don't pay attention to the hotel motel tax when they're going to destination cities. Is that correct? Like Nashville, for example, I went to the Titans game a couple weeks ago and we got beat by Buffalo. We had more Buffalo fans than we did Titans fans. So they're coming into a destination city. They don't pay attention to the taxes. Is that correct?
Right. When compared to other cities that they might just be passing through, where they might be more sensitive, destination cities, they were less.
If they're coming to do a vacation and they've set their mind on coming to Nashville or Memphis or Knoxville or Chattanooga, wherever, they're not worried about it.
The best example in any of the states.
Or Henry County or Carroll County.
Yeah. The best example was Hawaii. They didn't seem to be concerned at all about the lodging tax.
Well, if I had enough money to go to Hawaii, I wouldn't be concerned either. But that's just something. So everything is, and I guess one question I had, if you've got, let's say, for example, here in Nashville, if the taxes, and you sort of alluded to it a little bit, if the taxes are much higher in Nashville than they are in Lebanon, for example, or Franklin, or could you tell a difference where the individuals would go on through Nashville and stay right outside in a bedroom community instead of because of the taxes? Could you detail that?
It's possible if there were a study that it would find a difference. The study that was done was two cities in Texas, Odessa and Midland, that are like twin cities with an airport in between them. And so lodgers are faced with pretty similar options between the two cities, and one of the cities had a higher lodging tax rate, and so the study did find that the hotels in the other city did a little bit better.
Yes, sir.
One more question. Did you find out what they did in Georgia this last year? Did you look and see what they did? They added a $5 tax per hotel room. It didn't matter if it was a Ritz-Carlton or a Motel 6. They added a $5 per room tax, and that money goes to transportation. There was a lot of meeting that I went to over the summer. There was a lot of wailing and gnashing of teeth over that in Georgia. That happened just this past legislative session.
Yes, and we have a table. It's on page 9 of the draft with other bordering state lodging tax rates, and Georgia will be, of course, among them.
Other questions? Yes, Representative Carter.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. This never dawned on me prior to us looking at this, because I don't stay in hotels very often, just sleep in the car. But I think it's between Manchester and Murfreesboro, a billboard was erected by Franklin, Kentucky. And have you seen? Yeah, 2 hours away, and it brags about how low their room tax is. So I thought, goodness, are we so out of line? People are using that as a competitive advantage. So I know that someone's spending $2,000 or $3,000 a month to advertise that. I think the town's Franklin, Kentucky, I believe it's that. So somebody's paying attention to it.
Well, to that point, Mr. Haskell is here. Dan Haskell is here and asked if he could say a few words, and I think we'd like to hear from the industry, from him on the industry's behalf. Good morning.
Thank you. Good morning, Chairman Norris, members of the commission. I'm here on behalf of Greg Adkins, our president, who was unable to attend. So some of my remarks are basically his thoughts, and some are responses of what you said. I would say that I was the first one to note the Franklin, Kentucky sign, which is the original one is north of Goodlettsville, which is fairly close to Nashville, and the difference is fairly significant up there. It's 15 miles away. I guess it's probably 30 miles from Nashville. Let me begin by saying this is a tremendous report. This is part of the reason why we asked that this be done, because it puts in one report a lot of very complicated information, different entities, different rates, different methods of arriving at those rates, and a lot of different effects on Tennessee businesses and our travelers. I do want to take issue with one of the presumptions. the presumption that customers don't care about room taxes. I would note that the report says there are studies on that fact, but they are not noted in the report in any way. I would state, as a longtime general counsel of Opryland Hotel, if you're selling a 1,000-room hotel, in that case a 2,900-room hotel, to folks, this is a major factor. When somebody is a travel planner for a major association, a medical association, a bar association, the NRA, coming to Nashville, they have a grid. And one of the 10 factors on that grid is hotel taxes, because we're not talking about $2 or $3 a night here. We're talking about $100,000 a night in additional taxes because the cost is over so many rooms. In addition to those kinds of things, which don't affect everybody, the professional traveler is fairly sensitive to this issue. We've had a number of situations in Tennessee where there are rural cities that are near one another along the expressway, and there's a significant difference between one and the other. And the professional salesperson who's traveling in that community weekly or monthly and is familiar with those things is normally fairly sensitive to that kind of thing. The other thing is, I doubt there's any one of you who's not traveled with your wife someplace, and on checking out of that hotel, been told, we will never stay in that place again because those taxes were so high. You know, I thought I was paying $100 a night for the room, and it ends up being $130 a night for the room. Some people are sensitive to these things. The big picture in this state is about avoiding what we already are. We are, in many cases, the highest hotel tax in the country. And when I talk about hotel taxes, I'm talking about the total tax load on a hotel room, so I'm including sales tax. You've got your 9.25 to 9.75 plus some number. That number comes from counties and cities, and in cases of metropolitan governments, there's some special statutes, some of which I had something to do with passing. But in our industry, particularly for destination cities, numbers in the total that are in the 17 or 18% area seem to be bearable. When they're higher than that, it's a real problem. And the place where we're seeing particularly high taxes in this area is largely in small towns. Every year the General Assembly is asked to increase the tax in 6 or 8 small cities. And by and large, the money is spent by putting it into the general fund. Hotel taxes that are not reinvested are short-sighted expenditures. If you spend the money properly, as our friends in Nashville and our friends in East Tennessee do, it brings back way more money than you spent on doing it. We also have competitive disadvantage issues. Around Nashville, you have the bedroom communities with lower taxes. In most of the state, we're surrounded by eight other states, a wide variety of taxes there. Obviously, Senator Tracy mentioned the $5 additional tax that was imposed in Georgia. We would be vigorously opposed to that. What you do is you create a hardship for business owners who created a business based on a certain tax plan in a place they built that business. It's not like a lawyer or an accountant where you can pick up and move to another county if it's a problem. They've built millions of dollars worth of buildings in your county, and when you increase the taxes and move their business elsewhere, that's a real problem. The American Economics Group has done a report on this subject, which has been recently reviewed and updated. They said, and admittedly this was something that was financed by the National Hotel the Hotel Association, that room taxes and the economic impact, the title is Room Taxes and the Economic Impact on the Lodging Industry. They conclude that a 2% increase in room taxes will result in a ridiculous decrease in overall economic activity. That report is available to you, and one of the things we'd like to do is submit some written comments and provide that report to you. I would note out of that report that they reflect that the national average of tax on a hotel room is about 12.5%. Just as sort of final remarks, I would note that you've got to think about who you're competing with. Our big operators are competing with places like Charleston at 10%, Austin at 15%, Charlotte at 13.9%, Louisville at 14.5%, even our national capitals at 15.8%. We have all of our big cities. Memphis is at 16.5%, Nashville's at 16.7%, plus $2.50, which is hard to reduce to a percentage, and Chattanooga is at 15.8%. A number of our smaller cities are higher than that. That's where the problem really lies. In the big cities, the hospitality industry has largely been involved in the discussions about raising the taxes and what level they're raised to and to what purpose they might be put. We're spending the money in Nashville, bringing more people here. We built a convention center, which is bringing in enormous amounts of money, and anybody who's been in this town lately notes the number of cranes present, and a lot of those cranes are building hotels. Because this money has been invested in a way that brings back a lot of additional money and creates a lot of additional jobs. I'll be happy to answer any questions, but once again, we will like to provide some written additional
comments. Without objection, we'd welcome those written comments. And we do have some questions. Representative Carter.
Dan, you've been in this a long time. Let me make sure I'm reading this correctly on page 9. What the study, which is an excellent study, says is that's the combined sales and lodging tax. So Chattanooga's at 17.25. Do I understand this correctly? I deduct 9.75 off that, and I get what the local governments are charging for room
that's
tax,
correct.
About 6.1%, which I don't run a city, but that seems pretty reasonable, 6.1%.
It's the total that makes the difference.
No, I get that. I'm just trying
numbers.
To.
Chattanooga is one of those towns that has, and if you pardon me with a minor deviation, I was preparing to stand up in front of the Senate Finance Committee 10 years ago and rail against an increase in the hotel tax in Chattanooga. And I got a call because we'd just gotten cell phones in those days, and you could get up-to-date information. And the head of the local hotel association called me and said, we're changing sides. We're for this. They're going to spend the money doing the things that will bring more people here, the downtown developments in Chattanooga, the riverfront improvements. They spent the money doing the right things, and Chattanooga is a huge example of what you can do right.
I was just going to say, I've got a friend that owns 3 hotels, and he hasn't voiced any opposition to this because the money is designated to be spent for tourism and development and things like that, and he feels like it's an investment that he's making money on. So it's pretty odd to have an independent, conservative, Republican businessman laud what the city of Chattanooga's done, and he's very complimentary of him.
We have supported that there. We have supported it here in Nashville. We have supported it in Knoxville. It's the small towns who want to raise the tax 3 or 4%, get the total up to 20, and use the money to buy light bulbs. And I understand that small towns need to buy light bulbs. The other report reflected that tourists use roads, and therefore they need to pay for roads. They're buying gas here, so they're paying for roads. They're buying food here. They're contributing to our economy in a huge way, and we're not educating their children, although I would reflect that a significant percentage of our tourists in this state are Tennesseans. They're Memphians going to Gatlinburg. There are people from Knoxville going to Chattanooga. I went to Lookout Mountain last week.
I've got Senator Yarbrough, Mayor Huffman, Mayor Rowland, Chairman. Senator Yarbrough.
I've stepped in it now.
It's great. It's almost like broadband.
Dan, I appreciate you being here and speaking about this. I mean, obviously, you know, tourists being in town and being, you know, paying our restaurant taxes, sales taxes, all the taxes that they pay along the way is and just good for the economy and creating jobs and all of that. The and so an increase in tourism is seemingly very good for the Tennessee economy. So my question is, where do you, you know, sort of representing the industry, where are you seeing the increases that have come from to Tennessee? And I'm sort of curious, like, you know, do you see that in, based on people that have, you know, that are, where you've got conventions that are making decisions at a, you know, 1,000 rooms or several hundred rooms at a time? Do you see it based on the affordability of coming? I mean, what's really driving that increase? Because I think we need to know what we're trying to incentivize and what we're not.
If your question is why do people come to Tennessee for tourism, the answer is that we're within a day's drive of 80% of the population of the country. The same reason that Opryland Theme Park was built here back when you were a child and I was a young lawyer. We're an easy place to get to. There are a lot of attractions here. It's a beautiful state. We have entertainment. Music is something unusual. Downtown Nashville has provided a new kind of attraction in recent years that nobody anticipated. Knoxville and Chattanooga are doing the same thing. Memphis is working at that sort of thing. I expect you'll see legislation on that subject probably this year. The place where we're having the rates that are too high and not spent on things that they need to be spent on are basically in small towns where they're under financial pressure. And they find, I'm reminded of one, and I'm not going to name the city because somebody will throw things at me, but they wanted to buy an old building downtown and tear it down and create a parking lot. And so they were going to raise the hotel tax 4% to do that. Well, it wasn't going to help the hoteliers at all. It was just going to create a parking lot downtown, and mostly to be used by government officials and lawyers and the like. But they needed that, and eventually they did it. But we spent some time up here fighting about that. We have, 2 years ago, the House committee killed every tax bill that came up here of this type. Last year, they approved most of them. The difference is mostly the different people on the committee, but our position has been that if you keep the taxes, you know, at 18% or less, and you spend a significant amount of money on things that bring people back to your community, that you benefit in the long term. You don't benefit tomorrow, but you benefit in the long term in a way that is so much larger. If you look at the cities that are doing that, you look at Chattanooga, you look at Nashville, you look at Knoxville, they have done things that have made a difference in their communities over time that is unbelievable.
And are there examples of where, you know, sort of not the big four cities, like have you actually earmarked this for tourism development and used it well and to their economic advantage?
If you look at most of the private acts or the exceptions to the general act which have passed in the last 10 years, most of them have been earmarked, at least to the majority, most of them 100%, because the city wanted to do something like that. And what is a tourism draw is a really complicated question. 10 years ago, I would have stood up here and railed against building ball fields. And then I took my teenage son all across the state, and we spent a lot of time in hotel rooms and ate in a lot of restaurants because we were playing ball somewhere. If you can get a soccer tournament in your small town, it's a big deal. And that's tourism. That's the kind of thing that we want you to spend that money on.
Mayor Huffman.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I'm somewhat confused about the hotel motel tax issue because the folks that complained to me about hotels and motels in Tennessee, it's not about the tax, it's about the price. used to be $100, then it went to $150, then $200, and then $250, and then $300, and then $350. So I'm sure there's a point where the tax could be too high and it would hurt the economy. But from a local government standpoint, the fact of the matter is we have very narrow tax base. If you're a county, you live or die based on your property taxes, and we know what the value of property's done in Tennessee over the past few years. If you're a city, you live or die based on sales tax revenue. We know what that's done until recently overall because of the recession in the economy. So part of the reason for the hotel motel tax is to try to fill that gap, to just provide basic services that municipalities and counties in Tennessee are supposed to provide. One question I had was, it looks like the gap between an area and another state, the highest gap is Memphis compared to North Mississippi. And I think South Haven was the comparison in the report. Tunica down there, which is below South Haven, is also a competitor. I've never been down there. I understand Larry has. But does the industry know what impact that has on the state of Tennessee and the revenue, local government revenue from hotel motel tax? Because we've got Memphis that's on the border. We've got Clarksville. We've got Chattanooga. We've got the Tri-Cities area up there in Bristol. Do you know if there's been an impact on the local economy and the state economy based on our hotel motel tax versus the tax in these other states? Because almost all the states around Tennessee have lower consumption taxes. And, of course, Madam Director, we've talked about this before, the outflow of sales tax dollars in Tennessee going out to some of these other areas is pretty significant. Has the industry done any comparisons in that regard?
I don't have in my hands a study on that subject, but I think you've hit exactly on what the issue is. Hotel taxes are not about hotel taxes. Proper use of hotel taxes is about increasing your sales tax. That's where the money shows up in your place. And if it, in Johnson City you can stay, or in Bristol you can stay in Bristol, Virginia, for $10 less because of the taxes, and I'm sorry, I can't. You can derive those numbers probably out of the appendixes to the report, but I have not done that. It's a problem for those border cities, but it's a problem that we face in every part of financing government here. Higher sales taxes here and higher hotel occupancy taxes here, it means people, given the chance, will go to Kentucky. People will buy their groceries in Kentucky if they within 20 or 30 miles of there.
How is the industry doing in Tennessee overall? I mean, it looks like it's doing awfully well. Do you have any numbers on what the industry, what the revenue looks like now?
Yes, we can provide you those numbers, and we'll do that. I would say to you that during the recent downturn of the 07 and forward, the hospitality industry is the only industry in the state of Tennessee that continued to grow, that continued to hire more people, and continue to pay them more, because Tennessee has been in a peculiar place in the tourism industry. Our friends in East Tennessee found the goose with the golden egg, and Nashville figured that was a good thing, and now we see others who are doing the same thing. If you spend the money right, you will reap a huge increase in sales tax.
Thank you.
I've got Mayor Rowland, Chairman Wirgo, and then Mayor Waters.
Good, thank you, Mr. Chairman. City of Cleveland does not have a hotel motel tax. Bradley County does. We just fell asleep when they passed it, and all the hotels are in the city. A Chattanooga attorney who was staying at one of our hotels called me one morning, and he said, I stayed over 30 days, and that should not cause me to have to pay the tax. So I referred him to the county mayor. What is the definition of long-term or short-term stay?
At 30 days, you're no longer considered a transitional person, and it's like you're renting an apartment. Actually, one of the discussions that led to last year's bill that was amended to bring us to this point was the possibility of taking 30 days and moving it to 90 days. The difference between renting a short-term apartment and having a room for a night, I mean, technically, if the question is how does that work, you pay the taxes every day for 29 days, and on the 30th day, they give you credit. And if it's enough, you may pay nothing for that day and then every day thereafter. However, and I would note for the legislators, it's got to be consecutive days. And so those of you who go home on Thursdays, find yourself paying the taxes again the next week.
He said he was an extended stay client, so he wanted his money back that period of time. That's where those Chattanooga attorneys are. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Chairman Wirgo.
Thank you. Dan, you and I have had lots of discussions about this, but what I've heard from you today is you're okay with the fact of 17 or 18% as long as some of the monies are going to the tourism to enhance tourism. But you're not okay with the counties, and I've gone through here and I looked at my counties. Benton's at 14.75%. Henry's at 14.25%. Even when we combine a little bit with McKenzie, with Carroll County, we're still at 14.25%. I'm surprised. I thought it would jump a little bit then, but it doesn't. And then we're at 14.25% over in Stewart County. I know in Henry County we spend over $500,000 a year in tourism, and we don't generate that much money from hotel motel tax. How can you be comfortable with the tax rate if you're complaining about the tax rate of 17 or 19%? You can be disappointed with it if the counties are taxing for other reasons. I would think that would be the percentage overall, no matter what county it is, under what circumstances, that would be a bother to the tourism folks.
If the percentage is over 18%, we're obviously concerned about it no matter how the money is spent, because that puts us on these charts at places nobody else is. It's cheaper in Washington, D.C. It's cheaper in New York. New York City raised their occupancy tax to 21% in the middle 90s. And in 6 months, they lost a third of their business. In the seventh month, they changed their taxes back to 15%, where they are today. I could be wrong with the exact numbers, but they are the best example of what happens when you think, well, these people are all coming here, and we're in New York City, and they'll pay whatever it takes to get here. And those giant meetings that make the numbers in this business said, no, we're not. They went to Kansas City or Nashville.
And I get to protect the industry. I get that and understand that. But even earlier in your statement, you said from 2007 on, we've been increasing. I mean, even Governor Haslam this year allowed an additional, I believe, $6 or $7 million into the tourism because of how well tourism is doing. So, I mean, we have been on the cusp of the tourism here in Tennessee that just keeps rising and growing. And it's, I mean, honestly, it's vital to these small rural communities, you know, for that tourism. And obviously, I think we're doing a good job overall as a state. Maybe we should go back to some type of an honor system for those that stay in their car. And I'm sure my good friend to the left who claims that he does, maybe we put an honor system in that for a room tax on spending the night in the car, and we get some extra checks from that. But, I mean, back to getting serious, I don't understand how we're comfortable with 18% in one county, but we're not comfortable with 18% in another county. I'm having a tough time getting my mind wrapped around that.
The people that we've talked about have all been people who were opening the door to 20%, opening the door to 19% or 21% without any focus on what are we going to do with the money. Even Nashville, which has led the way in most of these things, when they passed the first hotel occupancy tax back in the middle 70s to build our first convention center, 80% of that money was dedicated to tourism. It's a specific mix of what they use it for, but 20% of it goes to the general fund. And that's, frankly, that was the number that was in the bill we had, because that has been a fairly successful model.
Well, I would hope that some of the mayors would chime in on this, but I think what you're going to see is I think that you'll see part of the legislation process, and then it's just a matter of a numbers game where these guys are switching their budgets around to pacify for the bill to say, okay, a percentage of this is going to that we're already spending on tourism, we'll just say, okay, this money's going to go to tourism now, and then we'll use our other monies to help for our convention center or something. I think it's we're just going to create just a numbers game or a loophole system for that problem. But
as we discussed previously, there were a number of situations where cities and counties were spending money promoting tourism but not taking credit for it.
Let's see, Mayor Waters was seeking recognition. You may have a comment on that. Mayor Waters?
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. It would seem to me, Dan, that the industry would have has really got three issues going on here. One of them is a sales tax, and obviously Tennessee's bread and butter is the sales tax, and it's higher than a lot of areas because we do not have an income tax. So that's one issue because we have a high sales tax. Then you couple that with a hotel motel tax, which is on top of that. And then the third is that the industry is looking at the usage of that hotel motel tax. Now, in Sevier County, we have two or three things. One, the cities have a 3%. Gatlinburg, Pigeon Forge, and Sevierville each has 3%. And the county has a 3%. But that's not on top of what the cities, each city collects their own inside the city limits, and the county collects 3% outside. And we divide that between school system infrastructure, the county's portion, and marketing. We get around $5 million a year in hotel motel tax in the county, and we spend $2.5 million in education because we think that's a priority. We're trying to keep folks there and keep them in the service industry as well as other industries to wait on and serve our tourists, so we think that's a good investment. Now, we do put $2.5 million into marketing, so we're trying to reach that balance that we think is appropriate. But it would seem to me that those are three issues that you all are looking at, and you're saying that 18% is probably the maximum. By the way, if you all will want to come to Sevier County, I tried to get a room in Nashville this week, and $369 was the lowest rate I could find downtown. So somebody's doing well downtown. We don't charge that in Sevier County, by the way, if you all want to come up there, not near that. But, you know, so there's three elements I would think the industry is wanting the legislature to look at, the total, what the usage would be, and if our hotel motel tax exceeds what is going on in surrounding areas and competitive areas that we have with Tennessee. Is that pretty accurate?
Yes, sir.
All right, well done. All right, Representative Carter.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. For Mayor Huffman, they built a Costco less than, I think, 3,600 feet in Georgia because of the wine and stores business, I'm told, was the factor that caused them to move to Georgia, whether that's true or not. Don't know, it's just what I was told. But I was down there the other day, and my wife commented, are you noticing there are no cars from Georgia here? So I counted two rows, and it was 77% Tennessee car tags. When I went in, there were two wedding planners who were buying champagne and wines and all these different things. I assumed they were going to put on a wedding that had cart after cart. One of them was over $2,900 in purchases, and they had a truck from Tennessee outside. So it definitely had an effect on us. Eastridge is right next to Costco, and I don't know whether the city mayor has seen a loss there, but it's pretty amazing. It's a 7% sales tax, so it's 2.75% you save on a $500 grocery bill. Plus, people say it's the wine in the store you can buy as you're buying your groceries. I think the fact that it's a third of the price it is in Tennessee may be the driving factor, but definitely these taxes will send people a mile out of state. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Okay, thank you all very much. Thank you, Dan. Appreciate it. Thank you, Mr. Mount. We're wherever you are back there, Michael. Thank you very much. Good work. We've had Representative Rogers join. There she is for the next item. Thank you for being here. Behind tab 7. Jennifer, yes, there we are. Good morning. This is on the subject of county employees serving on county commissions, another draft report for our consideration. You may proceed. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Chairman and Commissioners. Good morning. My name is Jennifer Berry, and I'm presenting the draft report addressing county employees serving on county commissions for your review and comment today. The draft report is behind tab 7. The report responds to a request from both the Senate State and Local Government and the House Local Government Committees to study Senate Bill 466 by Bell, House Bill 985 by Rogers, which was introduced earlier this year. A copy of the bill is included as an appendix on page 24 of the report. In the next few minutes, I'll give you an overview of the issue, describe the current conflict of interest laws here in Tennessee, explain what the proposed legislation would do, and describe some other ways to limit conflict of interest. All governmental leaders will deal with conflicts of interest when their personal, professional, or public interests compete. And citizens elect their leaders and expect them to make objective decisions that benefit the general public and not their personal interests. Avoiding all conflicts of interest is not realistic, but managing all types of conflicts of interest is critical to good government. Tennessee has laws in place to address conflicts of interest in city, county, and state government. All public officials and candidates are required to submit disclosure statements of interest to the Tennessee Ethics Commission. And although the Ethics Commission does not have the authority to monitor the content of the statements or enforce any penalties for behavior or conduct, it does issue civil penalties up to $10,000 for not filing or updating the statements on time each year. Also, every city and county is required to adopt and submit a code of ethics to the Ethics Commission, addressing acceptance of gifts and disclosure of conflicts of interest, and they're also required to make the policies available to the public. The general conflict of interest law prohibits public officials and employees at all levels of government from having a direct or indirect financial interest in any contract or work they vote on, let out, oversee, or supervise. And as defined in the law, a direct interest is any contract with the official personally or with any business in which the official is the owner, a partner, or the person with the largest share of the company. For example, an elected leader who owns a business that contracts with the government would have a direct conflict of interest. A provision in the general conflict of interest law has been interpreted as an exception to allow state legislators, but not city or county legislators, to vote on budgets, even if they have a direct conflict of interest, unless the vote is on a specific amendment to the budget or a specific appropriation or resolution in which that person is directly interested. Officials can have an indirect interest in a contract and still vote on a related matter, but must publicly acknowledge their interest, usually at a public meeting when the governing body is discussing and voting on that contract. As defined in the law, an indirect interest includes any contract in which an official is interested, but not directly interested, as well as contracts in which the officer is directly interested, but is the sole supplier of goods or services for that city or county. Indirect interest is also interpreted to include contracts with official spouses if the spouses combine their funds. The general conflict of interest law is usually applied to purchasing and business contracts, but is also interpreted to include employment contracts because employees would have an interest in their salary and benefits. Personal financial interest is the key to determining both direct and indirect interests. An official who violates the conflict of interest law, whether directly or indirectly, must forfeit pay and compensation for the contract, is dismissed from office, and is ineligible for the same or similar position for 10 years. Current law allows county employees to serve on their county commission unless they serve in a countywide elected or appointed office, which includes the constitutional officers, and those are the mayor or the executive, sheriff, trustee, register, county clerk, or property assessor. And also, they would not be able to serve if they were the director of schools. Tennessee counties have a clear separation of powers set by the changes made to the state constitution in 1978. Because they have separate legislative, executive, and judicial branches, they are similar to the state and federal governments, but unlike many of Tennessee's cities. Members of the legislative bodies, called the county commissions, who may be county employees, have only indirect influence over the non-legislative parts of county government. The elected constitutional officers share the executive duties and run the day-to-day operations of the county. The separation of powers lessens the possibility of direct conflicts for commission members who may be county employees because they have only an indirect influence over the other parts of county government. A summary of Tennessee's county government structure is on page 11 of the report. Unlike county commissions, the legislative bodies of many cities do have direct administrative control over operations, and the laws are different for their employees. City and metropolitan government employees cannot serve on their legislative bodies unless those bodies vote to allow it. If they do allow their employees to serve, the same exception for voting would apply as it does to the county employees. Many state employees can also serve as state legislators, unless the employment position is an appointive office or a place of trust as described in a statute. So, for example, a state park ranger or a TDOT employee could serve as a state legislator, while a commissioner of a department reporting to the governor would not be able to serve. Tennessee's general conflict of interest law also includes an exception for employees who serve on the commission of the county that employs them, depending on when they began their employment. Local legislators who were government employees when they were elected may vote if they have a conflict of interest in a matter by making a public verbal statement before the vote. Local government legislators who became government employees after being elected cannot vote if they have a conflict of interest. And those members who abstain because of a legitimate conflict must inform the chairperson, and their vote is not counted when determining the majority vote. The vote of a member having a conflict of interest who does not inform the governing body will be void if challenged during the meeting and before further business is transacted. Despite the conflict of interest laws that are currently in place, there are still some concerns that the laws are not sufficient to protect the public interest when elected members of county legislative bodies are also employees of the county. And the legislation introduced earlier this year, Senate Bill 466 by Bell, House Bill 985 by Rogers, would have addressed the concern by disqualifying all county employees from serving on the county commission of the county that employs them. The restriction would not apply to members elected before December 1st, 2015. Current commissioners re-elected on or after December 1st, 2015 could continue to serve as long as there is not an interruption in their service. In addition to the bill referred to us for study, another bill was introduced last year, Senate Bill 1513 by Gresham, House Bill 1481 by Faison, that would have forbidden all local government employees to serve on the legislative bodies of the governments that employ them. And that bill was amended to prohibit these members voting on matters in which they have a direct financial interest. The amended bill passed in the Senate but never made it to the floor of the House. Some stakeholders say that county employees who serve on the county commissions might be biased toward county government and their own interests. But others say that in some of the most rural counties, the schools and the county government are the biggest employers, and prohibiting county employees from serving would eliminate some of the most able, knowledgeable, and willing candidates. And in a number of counties, employees do make up a good percentage of the county commission. We surveyed the 92 non-metropolitan government counties. We didn't include the metropolitan counties because those employees, metro employees, are already prohibited from serving. Of the 92 counties that we surveyed, we received responses from 69 counties. Of the 69 counties, 81% of their commissions have county employees serving. And in about one-third of those, county employees make up more than 20% of the total commission members. In a review of other states' laws, we found that half of the states, including Tennessee, do have statutes addressing this issue. 17 states prohibit county employees serving, and 8 allow it. We also discovered that Tennessee's county government structure is somewhat unique. Unlike county governments in most other states, because of that separate legislative, executive, and judicial branches. We found only 4 other states, county governments, that are similar to Tennessee's with a legislative body and an elected county executive. Of these 4, only Alabama forbids county employees serving, and only Arkansas allows it. And the 2 other states that have similar structures to ours are Hawaii and North Dakota. And neither of these states have statutes allowing or prohibiting employees from serving. And a summary of what we found in other states is included in Appendix D on page 32. Conflict of interest practices could be strengthened to make conflicts more apparent and to further limit the situations in which commission members influence decisions to benefit themselves, their businesses, or their families. I will highlight a few examples of ways to limit conflict of interest that come from past legislation in Tennessee, discussions with county representatives and stakeholders, and a review of the laws in other states. Various county representatives and stakeholders suggested during interviews that commissioners who accept county jobs after being elected could be required to resign their commission seat, but then allowed to run and again serve in later elections. Currently, commissioners who accept county jobs after being elected cannot vote if they have a conflict of interest. Another bill was introduced and considered earlier this year, Senate Bill 1288 by Hensley, House Bill 1278 by Butt, that would have forbidden legislators to vote on any matter in which they or their immediate family had an interest, and it defined immediate family to include spouse, child, stepchild, brother, sister, son-in-law, daughter-in-law, parent, or grandparent of the member. And this bill did not pass. Some other states have statutes that restrict voting. 23 states have statutes prohibiting county legislators voting on matters if there is a conflict of interest, and 13 states forbid all county legislators to vote on matters if they have conflicts of interest involving their family members. During conversations with county representatives, we also learned that some Tennessee county commissions limit potential conflicts of interest by restricting commissioners' service on certain committees. When they're assigning their members to their committees, they can consider conflicts of interest, and we talked to several that do this. And for example, some might not allow developers to serve on a planning committee, or they might not allow the county employees to serve on the budget committee. Another way to limit conflict of interest is to specifically define it in the laws to clarify exactly what matters legislators can and cannot vote on. 16 states do this, and there are a few examples of specific language in the report on page 14 and 15. Seven states require county legislators to submit written disclosures describing conflicts of interest when they're actually voting. That would prevent them from voting on specific matters. Tennessee requires the verbal disclosure of conflict when voting, but not a written one. Three states require ethics training: Alabama, California, and Florida. And several government professional organizations, nationally, internationally, and here in our state, recommend training as a best practice. It's not required in Tennessee, but public officials can voluntarily participate in training. And CTAS offers training for county officials and employees in cooperation with the Tennessee County Services Association and the County Officials Association through their County Officials Certificate Training Program. The program includes technical, managerial, and ethics training for elected officials and employees to help them understand county government operations and better serve their constituents. And participants can work towards the public administrator certification or just take individual courses as they choose. Although no state requires it, the National Association of Counties and CTAS suggests that counties form local ethics commissions or committees to receive and investigate ethics complaints. According to CTAS, some Tennessee counties have established ethics committees to address complaints, but CTAS also makes it clear that these committees only screen complaints. They do not have any enforcement authority. If complaints are related to the issues covered in the county's adopted ethics policies, the committee refers the complaints to the appropriate persons or agencies to take action. And finally, many states, including Tennessee, have state ethics commissions, but only four states have ethics commissions with the power to enforce laws that affect county legislators. So to summarize, even though citizens vote for candidates and choose their leaders, strong conflict of interest provisions are necessary to ensure that elected officials who are in a position to vote in their own best interest cannot do so at the expense of the broader public interest. And although there are situations in which the knowledge and expertise of public employees can make them valuable members of policy-setting bodies, like the state and county legislative bodies, employees who report directly to those policy-setting bodies should not be able to serve on them, nor should members of their staffs. Rather than forbidding all county employees to serve on their county commissions, conflict of interest measures and provisions in the law could be strengthened to make conflicts more apparent and to further limit the situations in which commission members use their influence to benefit themselves, their businesses, or their families. And examples, again, of how to do this come from existing practices of Tennessee counties, previously introduced legislation, and other states' laws. And again, these examples include further restricting voting, restricting service on certain committees, more specifically defining conflict of interest in law, requiring legislators to disclose conflicts of interest, conflicts in writing when they're voting, require ethics training, create local ethics committees, and authorize state ethics commissions to enforce conflict of interest laws. And one specific idea for restricting voting that has been discussed is to allow county employees to serve as county commissioners, but not allow them to vote if a conflict of interest exists. And this idea would define conflict of interest as anything that improves their pay or benefits, or the pay or benefits of their spouse. This is just one example of a specific idea that's been discussed. And in addition, any commissioner who accepts county employment after they're elected could be added to the list of those that are currently forbidden to serve. And then if so, they would be required to resign their seat but could be allowed to run again in later elections. I appreciate your time and your input today, and I'm do my best to answer your questions.
Got a couple of questions for you. Mr. McMahon, you're recognized.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I appreciate it. Just a couple of clarifications. When you were going through early part of your presentation, you were talking about some of those constitutional offices, but did you mention judicial, that they're not allowed to serve on the county commission? And the reason I say this, there's a few counties that have a sessions court clerk that is an elected position, or a sessions judge, or a juvenile judge, because some places they have individual juvenile judge with a sessions judge, and or circuit judge. I mean, that's included too, correct?
Yeah, so any other countywide appointed or elected office
would
not be able to serve.
Okay.
So there's various examples of those other
Okay.
offices.
I didn't hear you say judicial. I might have missed it, and I'm sorry.
I didn't. I just named the constitutional officers.
Right. Now, the other question is, and this has come up before, and I think probably does all the time, when a county commissioner has a conflict of interest, and they announce that it's a conflict, and they don't vote, or they announce it's a conflict, they vote anyway, which happens in counties. If their vote doesn't count, does that vote mean, if they can't vote, that the majority number that is needed stays the same? For instance, in a county, let's say you're allowed constitutionally to have from 9 to 25 commissioners. Let's say you got 14, a majority is 8
mm-hmm.
out of 14. Does that mean that the majority that you need is less, or
yes,
that the majority stays the same and you just lose a few votes because they're not allowed to vote?
If they're abstaining because of a legitimate conflict, their vote does not count towards the majority. So, it's the majority of the whole body.
Right. Okay.
And so it would reduce the size, basically the size of the body, to determine the majority.
Okay. I'm confused because I've been told differently, and I just and I'll open up to any of my colleagues who might have a reflection on this. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. That's all I have.
Got Mayor Rowland seeking recognition, and I'll recognize him now.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Just a couple of definitions. Lucrative position, how do you define that? Is that based on salary, the amount of money, or percentages?
I'm actually not sure.
I know it's lucrative is mentioned several times. A part-time policeman and a constable referred to as not lucrative offices. I just wondered how you define a lucrative office.
So offices that report to, if it's defined in statute and they're reporting to the governor, the executive branch, or if it's an appointed office, it's considered lucrative.
I've just never heard that term before, but it's mentioned several times in the report. And also on the conflict of interest, in a county commission meeting, who would determine, that seems to be a gray area, who would determine if it's an actual conflict to overrule that commissioner from voting? Would be the chairman of the county commission?
While they're voting?
Yes, ma'am.
Well, that doesn't happen.
Let's say
that
the commissioner thought it wasn't a conflict and others thought it might be. Could the chairman make that decision?
That's a good question. I asked about that. It doesn't happen very often. And so I'm not clear on how that plays out if someone actually challenges the vote.
It's food for thought.
Yeah.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Thank you.
We had several who may want to respond. All right. Representative, yes. Mr. McMahon.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Jennifer, I believe maybe we're just strange, but in Cock County that comes up a lot. And usually in that situation, it's referred to the county attorney because the county chair doesn't want to make that decision, unless, of course, they're the one that has the vote that's in question. So, and that has happened too. But I would say that's. I'm just wondering. My point was: is this covered in new legislation? Is there anything that is talking about conflict of interest and how that would play out and. In any new legislation that's been proposed. That was the whole basis that I was asking. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. That's all I have.
Yes, sir. Brother Burgess.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I noticed there was a, on page 9, it says an ad hoc committee created by the Tennessee County Commissioners Association is currently reviewing the bill and considering possible alternatives, and they plan to make a recommendation. Have you received any input from that organization yet?
I have, and I do have permission to share what they voted on. And it's their language is, this is their recommendation, to allow a county employee to serve as a county commissioner but not be allowed to vote if a conflict of interest exists. They would define conflict of interest as anything improving their pay or benefits or the pay or benefits of a member of their immediate family, and they define immediate family as a spouse. That's what they've come up with.
Mayor Waters.
So, according to that, if I'm elected to the county commission and my wife is a school teacher, then I can't vote on the budget because the budget usually has a cost of living increase in it. And so, according to that recommendation,
is that I asked if they intended for to prohibit them voting on the entire budget, and they intentionally left that vague. they figured the General Assembly could figure out exactly, but yeah, that they didn't specify that.
Right. And this is just, you know, this is such a philosophical thing. On the one hand, you look at it and you think if the people in that district know that an individual is a county employee and they vote for them, who are we to say that they can't do that? But that's a philosophical thing. It goes into, you know, qualifications for office. We've got offices in local government that the President of the United States couldn't qualify for. So, you know, that's a large philosophical debate that we can have over this. But that's the debate that I think we've had at home is if somebody is an employee before they run, obviously the people in that district are going to know that person is a county employee. And if they vote for them anyway and have confidence in them anyway, you know, it's who are we to say that that's not an appropriate thing for the electorate to do, that we don't have confidence in them to make a good decision? I mean, that's a difficult thing to say.
It is difficult to say, and it was mentioned by many stakeholders that the bigger issue might be when they accept a county job after they're elected, which is where the suggestion came that they would maybe resign their seat in that situation.
Mr. Burgess.
Thank you again, sir. Just one follow-up question. Does this recommendation that you just read there from the County Commission Association, does that remove them now, the ability they have now to read this statement that they make and say, even though they have a conflict of interest, I'm voting my conscience, have they removed that ability in this recommendation that they're making?
What I read is the recommendation, so, but they did tell me that if someone has a conflict, they still need to let everybody know why they're abstaining. And they didn't say anything about indirect versus direct, so I'm not sure if they had an indirect conflict then if they would just read the statement. They didn't specify.
Thank you, Mayor Burgess. Chairman Tracy.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. This is a much more complicated issue than people want to think it is. I mean, it's a much, you know, you take my five counties, and like Mayor Waters said, I mean, when they run for office, people know they're sheriff deputies or they work for the sheriff's department, or they may be teachers that are teachers in that county. They're county employees. Is that correct? And so it's a little more complicated than what you think. Now, you know, if that recommendation by the County Commission Association we were just discussing up here, I mean, if you just don't vote, I mean, we vote up here all the time in General Assembly. We just declare in the Senate Rule 13 if it could be a conflict. If that's right, like Mayor Waters said, I mean, they could not even have to, they can't vote on the budget. I mean, you know, what's a conflict? And it's an interesting dilemma. I think there definitely needs to be an, you know, some ethics training and some discussion on it. And that, now one more question, because that was commentary. The question is, can each county come up with their own rules on this? Do we have to do anything at the state legislature to pass a bill? Can't Mayor Waters at Sevier County come up with their own rules of dealing with ethics, or Mayor Huffman or Mayor Burgess in their counties, can't they come up with their own ethics rules and broadcast them and have a hearing on it at the local level without us? I'm just asking.
Not unless they're a charter county. And each county has a code of ethics, but they still have to follow what's in the law. They could put something in their code of ethics that's more stringent than current law.
All right. Other, yeah, Mr. Mayor?
Yeah, I don't want to beat this horse to death on lucrative, but on page 30, second paragraph, a constable is not a lucrative office, and down about the center of the page, a constable is holding a lucrative office. Just wondering.
And those are just, as I looked at them, one was an attorney general's opinion in the first instance, and in the second
now there's a lawsuit.
Lawsuit. Yeah. So, but it shows the... that it can vary.
Thank you.
Yeah, we can try to clarify that as well.
Mayor Greer.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Jennifer, I appreciate your report, but rural governments especially are very challenged by what you're talking about. On our county commission, out of 15 members, we have 7 that would be in this potential conflict situation. All of them happen to be great commissioners. All of them have served a long time. And you were talking about the County Commissioners Association. I was at that meeting. It was very contentious, their discussion about that. And it wasn't the entire commission. It was those in attendance of that meeting. And you mentioned another thing that I'd like you to check on. Mm-hmm. You said if somebody proclaimed a conflict and abstained, the number for the majority would be reduced. So if we've got 15 members and 7 can't vote on the budget, we have 8. You're telling me that 5 members can then pass a budget instead of 8. Do we have an attorney general's opinion on that?
That's how that would work.
Okay, I've heard something to the contrary, so I wish you would study that and be sure that that is correct.
Okay.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Absolutely. Senator Tracy.
I think Mayor points out a good question. The rural areas are definitely challenged on this, and my personal opinion, you're better off to vote and just declare your conflict like we do up here in the General Assembly. You vote, and if you vote yay or nay, but you declare your conflict, and then if people don't like how you voted, they vote you out. And that's the way I think we're designed to do. That's the way we do it here, and if people don't like how you vote, they can vote you out. Because if you start changing the majority of who can pass a budget, that changes the whole complexion in these smaller counties for sure. You can have a small group of people. Like Mayor said, you may have out of in a small county, you may have half of the commissioners that could be declared as an county employee when you count teachers involved in that and all kind of employees, correct? Bus drivers. So all that in these smaller counties, it's a little more complicated than it sounds good till you start analyzing it.
Thank you, Senator.
Can I clarify, Mayor Greer, the law says any member of a local governing body who abstains from voting for cause on any issue coming to a vote before the body should not be counted for the purpose of determining a majority vote. That's how it's worded in the law.
There we go. Chairman Wergo.
I'll allude to a fact of a bill that came through local this year where we had to, by law, there had to be 5 commissioners in one of the rural cities. We had to reduce that number to 3 because they couldn't find 5 people to serve. So we had to pass a law to change it from 5 to 3. For rural areas, and I think that is the difficult thing that we, I appreciate the fact that we're studying this because this bill came through our committee, and I'm very listening very intensely because it's very vital. But I think Senator Tracy just brought up a very good point, as the mayor also stated, we're dealing with a whole different animal with rural and urban. Thank you.
Good discussion. Any other comments here? Or yep. I'm sorry, Representative Carter. Yep. Yep.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. This bill came before, I think Courtney Rogers, the representative that sponsored it in the House, is here. It came before our committee, and it's interesting, the origin of the bill, and please, I hope I get this right, Courtney, is it stems from Article 2, Section 6 of the Tennessee Constitution, Mayor, which declares in our Constitution that no appointment in the militia nor any office of the Justice of the Peace shall be considered a lucrative office or work as a disqualification to serve in the House of the General Assembly. Doesn't mention the Senate. I don't understand that. But I think that was the origin, that in our state constitution, we have a provision that I'm just making all this up, of course, that the governor can't get one of his representatives to run for a seat and then vote on his budget. It boils down to a separation of powers issue. I understand that, and I think Ms. Rogers is completely correct in her bill. It's like some other issues we consider in here. They're very complicated. Just like in the small counties, it doesn't work. It may be right in law school, or it may be right in a paper, a study, but it doesn't actually work. So I think all of this has to do with, remember that our counties are political subdivisions of the state. They cannot pass a law. They can only pass resolutions, I think, guys, and that's spend money. So then the conflict between the person spending money to benefit himself, his wife, or his children becomes more of a conflict. So I understand, like a good politician, I'm going to get right on the middle of the fence. I can see both sides of this. For the rural counties, I don't know how you would function if we had this disqualification. In Hamilton County, we have people run for office. I don't know what they do, Mayor. You know, I have to read the newspaper or see their push card because a lot of them are unknown to me. So I can see both sides of it. But I think it has a very sound basis both in Tennessee state law, the Constitution, and ethically. It makes perfect sense if we were drawing it. Also note that I think it was presented to us that all we're trying to do is bring the counties into line with all metro governments. Is that right, Courtney? In other words, this divide is not as broad as we think it is because it applies to Nashville, which may be the most metropolitan city in Tennessee, but it also applies to Moore County, which is one of our smaller counties. So it's a very complex issue, and that seems to be all we've taken up. It's been interesting, but very difficult to come to question. So,
well, Representative Rogers is here if she'd like to address any of these points. I know Mr. McMahon was seeking recognition as well.
Ms. Chairman, and I appreciate Representative Carter kind of cleared up some things there that my question was. Just to answer Mayor Rowland, though, that in Sevier County there is only one lucrative position, and that is the position of county mayor. Just want to let you know that. Yeah. Thank
Representative
you.
Rogers, would you like to say a few words? Thank you for being here today. Representative Rogers is recognized.
Thank you, Chairman. And I hadn't really planned. I was just coming here just to listen today. So forgive me for having to go to note and everything. My biggest concern and the reason for bringing forth the bill has to do with, it wasn't so much of individual conflicts of interest in a small contract or something that's very isolated that an individual can say. It had to do with the violation of separation of powers. And the key note in, the key word in the separation of powers is separation. And in 1978, we did that. Or I wasn't here. I'd like to say I was in high school, but I wasn't. I was in college. But that's what they did, is separation of powers. Well, again, the key word being separation. But when you allow crossfeed of same members in those two separated branches, your separation is compromised. Your separation no longer exists. Your own, and I looked at the report, and 69 county county commissions reported, so it means 26 did not, but more than a third or 23 counties had over 20% of county employees. Two had over 50%. An assertive executive could very well bring that 50% to 70%. And granted, it's the voters that vote, but it is hard as an individual citizen to compete with, and notice, but let's say a block of firefighters going through and doing the campaigns and having all the connections. I do want to clarify, I am not disparaging our county employees at all, because I do respect them. Matter of fact, in my own commission, I have county employees that it actually hurt me in thinking about running with this bill, but thankfully at least we had the clause, the grandfather clause, because there are good people. But our Constitution, the concept of separation of powers, was not established for good people. Our founders always were looking to restrict powers. You know, checks and balances were set up to avoid corruption, the corruptible, those that would obtain more power than they could, criminal, greed, covetousness, all of those type of factors. But even if you don't look at maybe failing characters of man, every person in office is corruptible, or is you can be coerced. If you've got a family, you can be coerced no matter what. And so what is the solution to that against that one individual? It is separation of the amount of power that that individual possesses. You cannot coerce them from outside to do too much. When you have the separation of powers, I think... And I tried to put this in an individual, just an example. And I'm not saying this to pass judgment. I'm just giving you food for thought today. Like I said, I was just looking at these things. You hire a plumber. And you hire a plumber, and you say, these are my priorities. And you can, and the plumber can tell you the price. And you can say, well, okay, that is fine. Where... can that plumber, where in the free market, can the plumber come back to your home and say, these are not my priorities. My priority is not your leaky faucet. It's I want to install, in your lawn, irrigation system or sprinkler system. Those are my priorities. And, oh, by the way, I have the authority to charge you more to take from you if I can go to another, you know, over within the legislative branch. And so the point being is the departments, I heard her say, what did she, named three things, I think individual, finance, the finance of your spouse, finance of your families, but it also has to do with your department. And we don't need the commissions to become the county government to become just another extension of a battle between the departments to separate, to establish their priorities. You need the citizens to be able to have a voice for them. And so
thank you.
I'm finished.
Thank you. Okay. Appreciate that. Yes, sir. Mayor?
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Just an observation. On page 30, I was looking at lucrative and non-lucrative that Mayor Rowland brought up. And it says a county commissioner may serve as clerk and master because these are not lucrative offices. Now, most counties, ours included, our clerk and master is the highest paid official in the county because of the special commissions that they incur along with their salary. If that's not lucrative, I'm in the wrong business. That needs to be clarified as well.
We've heard about that. Senator Yarbrough.
I just want to say, especially as someone who's in the first year on this commission, I think this is it's been a really interesting discussion. I mean, I think this is one of those challenges that we who believe in citizen government sort of always, you know, I think all of us in the legislature, most of us have outside employment. I think most people that serve on county commissions have outside employment. And, you know, which requires us to balance how do we deal with conflicts of interest. I mean, obviously you can eliminate conflicts of interest by paying full salaries to all of these people, but no, I don't think anybody wants to move to that, because I think that we do recognize the merit of having sort of a citizen field body here. And I also just want to, I think this has been, as someone who serves in the legislature, it's been a great opportunity to actually get the real world perspective from the local governments on this issue. I mean, I think that there's, it's just been immensely helpful to me, and I appreciate it.
Thank you, Senator. All right, are there any further comments on this report? Well done. And we'll look forward to the final report at our next meeting, which is scheduled for January 5th and 6th, as you'll see in your notebooks. And before, yeah, Lanish, do you want to mention what you told me today about some hotel availability and rates and things?
We just wanted to share that a couple of the members have already secured their hotel rooms for the meeting on the 5th and 6th of January, and we're able to get state rates. So those of you who haven't yet and need to, you might be able to get state rates if you went ahead and got those. And of course, if something happens and you have to cancel, then that should work out fine.
Yeah, there we go again. All right, you're out of order, Senator Tracy. Okay. I did mention yesterday, just want to make sure you're mindful that you have this additional handout that we talked about yesterday during broadband on the broadband technologies and applications performing at various speeds to supplement your materials. And if there is nothing further for the good of the order, we will adjourn. Thank you very much. See you in January.